election year 2020 rolls on, not all of it edifying or aspirational. Is it naive of me to hope it might be more so? But if we look in the stories in the news, accusations of electoral law fraud, essentially with the donation scandal, the housing crisis we've already spoken about this morning, a human rights violation according to the UN and in fact our own Human Rights Commissioner, and the looming threat of a global pandemic as well. We talked about that with Brad Olson earlier from Infometrics. Joining us from Wellington to inspire us with their capacity to make politics something we can believe in, our New Zealand First Minister Shane Jones and National Party Finance spokesperson Paul Goldsmith, welcome you two. It's nice to have you with us. Mōrena. Paul Goldsmith, can I start with you? I worry that we're becoming cynical about politics and politicians, and I worry that our cynicism is going to lead to an alienation, and fewer and fewer of us are going to listen when you guys talk and are going to vote come election day. How do we respond to that? How do we address that?
Well, it's certainly not the impression I'm getting out on the street. We go talking to people all the time. People are very passionate about politics in New Zealand. Right now, they're very frustrated with the way that the country's going under the government that we've got, and they want to change, and they're very keen to get involved in campaign. And so, no, that's not the impression I get. I think people want to see change, and they see the ability of politicians to make a difference if they get it right. What makes them cynical is if there's lots of talk, lots of announcements, and no delivery. And so that's what they want to see.
Shane Jones, what is it that you think people want to see from their politicians?
I don't think that society's fully engaged with politics. I think at the moment they're recovering from the holiday. They're getting on with the ordinary travails of life. I do think it's a good wake-up call, though, that at the end of the day we need to appeal to the finer sentiments of the voters and justify why we should hold our positions. But look, I wouldn't get too much in a funk, John. I don't think that there is a spirit out there of disbelief.
I hope you're right. Both your parties are the subject of investigations into donations that have been received.
No. Our party is not the subject of an investigation.
No, you're right. That is literally true. But
boy, well, it's a big difference. A big difference.
I don't know.
Paul, let John talk. Don't get too defensive, Paul. You've got your day in court coming up.
Paul, a former colleague of yours, who we are now able to name because the suppression has been lifted, is one of those charged. Now, he was a National MP when the alleged, and that's really important, this is sub judice, and nothing has been proven, when the alleged offences occurred. And I just wonder if this must be an exhausting line to run, to try and recuse the National Party from any involvement, when he was, at the time, your MP and your man.
Yeah, and he's left the caucus, and everybody knows the circumstances around that. And so, you know, what we're talking about here is a current National Party, nobody involved, the party organisation not involved. And it's a very sad set of events, and we're watching it closely.
Remind me what party the donations were going to.
Well, they were going to, allegedly, to the National Party.
Say no more.
And Shane Jones, remind me what foundation, the New Zealand First Foundation, what party they were acting for?
Well, the NZ First Foundation is currently embroiled in an investigation with the SFO. That's public knowledge. Now, whether or not the SFO find anything that takes them over the threshold to go to the next stage in the judicial process where the National Party currently are, that's up to them, John. I think the point that you're making, though, is that where I wouldn't want you to push the perception where there's money, there's muck. It costs money to run political parties and to deliver in the absence of state funding.
I don't want to interrupt, but justice must not only be done, it must be seen to be done. And we will draw the conclusion where there's money, there's muck, if political parties try to hide where the money's from. Surely transparency is the best solution to us not reaching the conclusion that where there's money, there's muck.
Absolutely, and that's very much the issue that New Zealand First have to answer. They have ministers, they're part of the government, they're making decisions around big government spending, and we want to have clarity about who the donations have come from. And the Electoral Commission has been quite clear that there have been things that haven't been properly transmitted, and so we're waiting to see that flow out.
Let's change the subject to the coronavirus. Brad Olson from Infometrics. This is potentially really problematic. I mean, in areas like Waikato, the West Coast, where they are big, big dairy exporters, and a large percentage of their dairy exporting goes to China, how the hell do we respond to this? Paul Goldsmith, can we start with you?
Well, yeah, I mean, it really is a potential major issue. It all comes as to how long it carries on and whether it's a short-term thing that we bounce back from or it drags on longer. And the sad thing is, of course, this is where we're already slowing as an economy before this happened. Last year was a very flat year. And so that means that it's a compounding problem for the New Zealand economy. On top of that, this government inherited massive surpluses. It was already projecting a deficit this year before this happened. And so there's fewer opportunities fiscally to respond. So you know, they're going to have to work their way through it carefully. The thing that really worries me is the impact that it's having, particularly on the small businesses that I see in the tourism sector, who are particularly in Auckland, where they're really struggling. There's a drop in demand, quite substantial drop in demand in that tourism space. But we also see it flowing through to international education and in the forestry sector.
Absolutely.
And now it could go even wider. So they're feeling real pressure at the moment.
Yes, Shane Jones, can I pick that up and pass it on to you? Forestry, of course, in the Bay of Plenty, I think about 15% of exports are forestry exports. This is a sector that you obviously feel very strongly about. What the hell can we do, given that the problems are external ones?
Well, you have already reported that I brought forward a suite of options for the forestry sector. I have to say that I have some anxieties that it could spread to horticulture and parts of farming, but I'm a lot more optimistic than Paul. The commodity prices out of farming have been stratospheric. So I don't want us to get in a situation where we have identifiable politicians, and Paul passes that threshold, being negative. The reality is when you trade with China,
these are
some of the consequences.
Is he being negative or is he being realistic? And is realism the required response to what could be? And the Reserve Bank is saying, we think it will be over relatively quickly, so let's hope they're right. Infometrics are saying this is going to take longer to resolve and it will be impactful.
And nobody knows the nobody knows.
Absolutely.
And that's the point. All you can do is in good government is be prepared for these sorts of things. Remember, I was a scout and I used to say, be prepared.
What is that preparedness looking like, Shane Jones?
Oh, I think we've got some lessons to draw on. The way in which small businesses were assisted after the Christchurch earthquake, the Kaikoura earthquake, there was a package recently for Whakaari. So it's not as if the government doesn't have experience on both sides of the house as to how do you assist industry. Mm. But it's also a matter of timing and ensuring that we don't feed the wrong sort of appetite. But look, I've got a host of options for the forestry sector. My other colleagues have warned me, though, it may not just be forestry you need to think about. So the ministers are working through that in a state of preparedness as we speak.
Shane Jones and Paul Goldsmith, thank you so much for joining us this morning. We really appreciate your time live from the Wellington studio.